This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the performing arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
Hello and welcome to the Hexacon Studio. This is Marjolaine Fournier. I'm sitting here with Jean-Jacques van Vlasselaer, and we're launching our new season of podcasts. Today, a subject that we both love very much, Mahler, and a subject that Jean-Jacques knows very well, which is his fourth subject I'm discovering. The Fourth Symphony, and I've been reading a lot. There's many writings. Unfortunately, I began my research by reading Alma's book, her biography, which is totally, I don't know where the truth lies. So let's put that one aside. There's many, many people have written very well about Mahler. Derek Cook is one of them, and Monsieur Donald Mitchell, who's written everywhere, everything, everybody refers to him. Anyways, my point being, there's a lot of writing about what Mahler meant about this symphony, that chord, this note, this orchestration is, what did Mahler think of his own symphony?
Ha! What did Mahler? He says, I think, give a moment to a friend of mine, just when he has finished that symphony, which he completes at the end of the summer, but perhaps at the end of the year also, 1900. So the work has been composed between 1899 and 1900, and in fact has been in his mind since 1895. And I will explain why I say that. But he says to a friend of his, my fourth is going to be very strange. And so the strangeness, keep that word in mind. And then it's going to be full of humor and naivety. Now, don't think Mahler is a naive man. Humor, yes, but humor as taking distance with reality. And so these are my starting points. So these few words by Mahler are very important and will be leading us through the rest. Well, I call it also the Fourth Symphony. I call it also Paradise Before Hell. And I will explain this in a few seconds, why Paradise Before Hell. Because the Fourth Symphony is a kind of description of child's paradise, and afterwards the Fifth Symphony that will come, 5, 6, and 7, will be a kind of interior description of what human hell can be about.
Making me, I've been reflecting a lot about this because this is all quite new to me. But his Fourth Symphony, you're talking about children, it very much, the whole thing sounds to me like somebody who goes for a walk and sees things but doesn't get that affected by them, sees storms brewing, sees maybe walks through town and sees villagers or sees neighbors or, you know, things are going on, never gets really affected. In the Fifth Symphony, he'll get his boots dirty. You know, he'll get in there and he'll feel things. But the Fourth Symphony is so, so different that way.
It's very different because one has to read it at that double level. And we will talk about that at that double level. But I do think that Mahler is putting an end to a cycle, which he called his tetralogy. That means, you know, like Wagner's Ring Cycle, he called it the end of his Ring Cycle. And in that comprises, of course, the three first symphonies plus this one. So, and we'll come back to that one. This symphony is in the middle of, in a way, it's the bridge that will take you into the other world.
Now,
and And the walk you were referring to, because I want to come back to that, is very true. The walk you were referring to, it is indeed, it is a wanderen. He has never been as close to Schubert, in fact, as in this symphony. There's that kind of Schubertian innocence that goes with it, but also the walking, but the walking in Schubert and in Mahler go towards what? It's always that incredible relationship between life and death. And this time it will be done through the eyes of a Catholic child, most probably a little boy, who's also Austrian. It's very Austrian. The Landler comes through it. The way you see the walk happening in the woods, it's the pastoral. It's a kind of pastoral walk, you know. And all these elements, say to yourself, yes, this is Austrian. This is an Austrian symphony. It comes closest to what Beethoven would have written in his pastoral symphony up to a certain point. But I'm coming back to your walk because what you said is so true. It is a walk. It's of somebody who's looking at the world, but he's looking at the world from a distance. He's looking from a world from a distance. And he has to do that because he has to take the eyes of the child.
Right.
He has to take the eyes of he looks through the eyes of a child. It's and by describing that, he takes distance from his own world. Takes distance of his own world. And this symphony is going to be also very symbolic of what music means to him. So what does life mean to you? That's what he has been trying to do from the very beginning. And I'm going to try to do two contextualizations, two ways to get that fourth symphony, to corner that fourth symphony in your mind. First of all, we are at the end of the century, and at the end of the century, 1897, there is the death of Brahms. That same year, Mahler converts to Catholicism. He will conduct, by the way, the Second Symphony in Moscow. You know, he gives his farewell concert in Hamburg, where he was the Generalmusikdirektor, where he was running the music world, and he is named head and director of the Hofoper in Vienna, which will become the Vienna Opera later. And so this is a very important move. He had to convert to Catholicism because that was the only way to get official titles and to be an official in the empire, the dying empire of Austria-Hungary at that time. So the year afterwards, in 1898, he composes two more Wunderhorn songs. It's important. This is the road towards the Fourth Symphony. Wunderhorn songs. Why are the Wunderhorn songs important? Because they will be the internal lead of the four first symphonies. You see, I'm cornering the four first symphonies for the moment through the Wunderhorn. They're being called the Wunderhorn symphonies, by the way. All four. So when one talks amongst the musicologists, one says, oh yes, well, this is part of the Wunderhorn symphonies, 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Can you clarify just in a few seconds, like the Wunderhorn, where is that from? What is the text from?
The Wunderhorn symphonies in two words, it is a very easy thing. In the 19th century, what happened? 19th century is the history century. It is the novel century. Novel, you know, people write novels, so and history. So these are two great characteristics of the 19th symphony. What do people do? They try to discover what the past is about. So people like Achim von Arnim and Clemens Brentano will try to find the poetry of medieval times. Very simple, very straightforward poetry. Poetry that has to do with every man. You know, every man in one word. So the worlds of life and death, the world of simple happiness, and so it's naive, it's unartful up to a certain point. And they went to get that. And on these songs, he has composed a whole series of songs. And so he will
put those songs within his first symphony. He will use two of them into his second symphony. He will use songs in the third symphony, and he will do the same thing for the last time in the fourth symphony. After that, the symphonies will become completely, well, the three next symphonies, six, five, six, and seven, will become purely symphonic symphonies. The other ones have singing in it.
And it's an incredible device when you have the... what you think is very round and silky sounds of the instruments, but then when a voice comes out, you realize it was all so rough before. That device is incredible.
The voices coming in the symphonies by Mahler are so moving.
Yes.
It is. These are moments of absolute reflection on what we are, what we be, and then the choice of those texts. You know, it is a killer each time. Yeah. It's a killer. So there we are in 1898, yes. We are in 1898, and he composes those another two Wunderhorn songs. He conducts the Ring Cycle, Tetralogie, the Ring Cycle by Wagner. He takes over the Vienna Philharmonic from Hans Richter, so he is the man in the music world, because these are the two great places to be at that time. The other one being Richard Strauss, of course, who will make his fortress in Berlin. So there will be the Vienna-Berlin traction. So 1899, he starts composing his fourth symphony, and at the same time, he's buying a plot of land at the countryside, Mayernig, where he will build his house, where he will be living for in the summers, of course, because he is, as everybody knows, a summer composer. He has so much work with the Vienna Philharmonic and with the opera, and being a top-level conductor, being and one who will be creating the new style of conducting. The great style of the great conductors of the 20th century comes straight out of Mahler's teaching. This is, he 1899, he composes the Fourth Symphony, and he, you know, this is going to be a very strange symphony, he says, because of what you were saying, which I tried to explain, that kind of distance taking. You don't have that in the Second Symphony. You don't have that in the Third Symphony. It really comes to an interior walk of somebody who wants to know what innocence is about. Let's go back to innocence. Let's go back to purity. Let's go to purity. But we know purity doesn't exist. So purity is something that has all kinds of other elements. All those that want to be pure are very dangerous very often, you know. We know the example with the Nazis. That was, you know, purity of the race. There you go. So it's going. Anyhow, this being said, he will continue the next summer and completes the Fourth Symphony in 1900. And at that time, he will be publishing, he'll have his Wunderhorn Lieder published, which is also an important moment. By the way, 2 years before, Gershwin was born already, and Bertolt Brecht. You see, the new world is there. That is an incredible thing. In 1900, when he finishes the Fourth Symphony, Aaron Copland, Kurt Weill are born. Isn't it extraordinary? I'm just put into perspective where Mahler was living and what is going to come after that. But he opens that world. In 1901, there is the premiere of the Fourth Symphony and the first performance of the Fourth Symphony. And what does he do? At the same time, he composes a new series of songs, Lieder, the Rückert, four of the Rückert songs. And he composes that same year, when he finishes that this childhood look on what the world could be about, the Fourth Symphony, he composes three of the Kindertotenlieder, three of the songs for the dead child or the dead children. And you say to yourself, what is this about? Well, he's getting into that next He's taking that next step. He's getting into that next world in which he's going to open up to tragedy.
That symphony coincides with the end of the century. It kind of coincides with... He must have been stirred up in a crazy way with Brahms leaving. There are many changes, but there's a mood, I'm sure, that was...
It's something that nobody expected. People didn't like the symphony. People didn't like the symphony first. They said, what is he doing? So what is he doing? Well, let's see where that symphony is placed within the four symphonies. Let's take that first. So symphony number one is a prerequisite to artistic creation. It's a very straightforward prerequisite to artistic creation, in which, of course, there is the hero, the one that survives, and there is already a death march. Yeah, already a death march. You take that the famous song Frère Jacques, and then he turns that into a death march. So all the ingredients are there. In the first movement of the first symphony, there is the childhood, all the things that went through his mind when he was a little boy, and where he had hidden from his father, and his father didn't find him, and he felt so lost. All this is in the first movement of the first symphony. And so that is the prerequisite to artistic creation. The second symphony, he's posing metaphysical questions. It concerns the relationship of humanity with religion. And that's why it's called the Resurrection Symphony. Resurrection, because there is also, again, an extraordinary death march in it. And that he opens up already on his internal world, which is the internal world taken between light and darkness, and has never been expressed as clearly as with Mahler, I think. And then he gets into the third symphony, and he's going to ask other questions. He's coming down to earth. The second symphony was those questions which you are asking to somebody beyond understanding, and the cosmological questions. Yes, there he goes with at the departure, seven movements. Oh yes, he had to do the 7 days of the week, the 7 days of creation. It's all entangled, and those cosmological questions in the third symphony are about what? Well, they're about the first movements are about the rocks of the world, so it's the earth itself. And then he gets, what does the animal world tells me? And then he gets into another movement. What do the plants tell me? And the forest. What does mankind tell me? And then the last movement is divine love. But somewhere in there was, what does childhood tell me? And it was too identical to another movement. So what he did, he took it out. And we are talking 1895. He took it out of the symphony. So six movements in the third symphony. And he will take that, and this will become the last movement of the fourth symphony, which is the heart of the symphony, which is the solution, the resolution of the symphony, and which will give all its themes to the three first movements. So the three first movements will prepare the fourth movement, although they're born from that fourth movement. It's a wonderful work, and a wonderful work of working, a way of working. This being said, there goes that relationship with the third symphony, but then the fourth symphony has already relationship with the symphonies that will follow. It is a very different symphony. It's only 50 minutes long. which is a small symphony in Mahler's writing. It is a classical symphony, as you know very well. It's in four movements. The sonata form is present. The four movements, you know, like the four movements in Haydn's symphony.
The sonata form, there's a scherzo, a real scherzo.
There is a real, a kind of real scherzo, yes.
And with a crazy fiddle in the middle. Yeah. Then there's variations. And then this song, this free song at the end, and you're telling us that really the solution to the enigma and the walk that goes, and you're wondering what, there's the solution at the end.
Yeah. And there is a solution.
Reward.
And we'll keep the solution for the end of this talk also. But the wondering, you use the right word. There is one is wondering what is happening, but one is wondering also.
Yes.
And so he takes us by the hand the way you take a child by the hand. But you are the child also. And he will take you through four movements, which will be very interesting four movements. We will go through them, of course, in a few moments. But we have to say some more things about that symphony in comparison with the other symphonies, because it's classical, and it is of a smaller orchestration also. We have been talking about that, you and I, but there are no trombones in it. And he himself regretted he didn't put any trombones in it for one or two moments within the symphony, the first movements, and by the end of the third movement, getting into the fourth movement, when he opened the doors of paradise. But so he regrets it up to a certain point, but it's a minimal large orchestra, let's call it like that, but not like the other orchestras by Mahler.
So there's still triple winds, four horns.
Yes.
And you need a lot of strings to support all that. But yeah, no trombones. I don't think it has the massive percussion either.
That massive percussion, yeah, which you have, for example, in the Sixth Symphony or in the Second Symphony also. So what he's going to do is that in that symphony, you have already some of the vision that will come in the following symphonies, because in the first movement of the Fourth Symphony, at a given moment, when the trumpet takes over from the flute, and when it gets into a much more hard sounds, you have the beginning of the Fifth Symphony, which starts
literally.
Literally, absolutely. And then the last movement of the Fifth Symphony has the same classical formation like the end of the Seventh Symphony. There are all kinds of elements. In his writing, of course, he progresses all the time. And even if the symphony is a classical form symphony, the way he plays around with the tonalities, he gets into the modern world, really into the modern world. And there are remarkable moments of composition in that Fourth Symphony. It seems so simple. Forget about simplicity. It is very complex. It seems so pure. It is not pure. Purity doesn't exist, and Mahler shows it. It seems serene. It's not serene. Tragedy hangs around. It seems first level. Never listen to a symphony by Mahler at the first level. You know, so all these elements we have to listen to and try to go. Now, I wanted to say a few words, if you don't mind, on the kind of innocence that we should be talking about, because when I speak about naivety and purity, I have not touched the word of innocence. And innocence, I do think, exists, contrary to all the other things we have just described. And I want to come back to a famous author of the 19th century. Mahler has read him. By the way, I have read him also because I like E.T.A. Hoffmann very much. By the way, E.T.A. Hoffmann, the French composer Jacques Offenbach, has written his Hoffmann's Tales. The famous opera Hoffmann's Tales are based on the book,
but it's
the same man, okay, of course. And the world of Hoffmann is fantastic, is dreamlike, is both painful and full of humor. Great author of them. And he has written a lot about innocence also. And one of his sentences says, "If men want to open their eyes and see what is in full light, they have to become children." So this is what this symphony is about. You want to understand what it is really. You want to see the full light of it. Have the eyes of children. And so Mahler's relationship with childhood is a very important one also. The childhood of those 14 children, of which 8 die right away in the family Mahler, has worked so much on his being, on his ego, on his outlook of life also. And especially when his little brother, who who came to the ripe old age of 13, Ernest dies. You know, the children in the family Mahler played games, his sister played games, being dead.
Is that true?
Oh,
really?
Yes. And they would put candles around her. The brothers would put candles around her, and they would just play being dead. So the notion of death and alive and the fragility of life, that fragility of life, which Mahler was so aware of, comes from that period, certainly. I will come back to that also if we have a second by the end of this presentation. So there he goes. He has this symphony in the back of his mind, in the real sense of the term, in the back of his mind. He gets to the third symphony, gets that symphony out, and he is... He's going to create three movements, which he picks out from the fourth movement. Fourth movement, a song, which he gets out of the Wunderhorn songs, which is a very naive song on getting into paradise and seeing how beautiful paradise is. This place where violins hang from the walls, you know, and where music, of course, is so important, that song will be the cornerstone of that whole symphony. And so we get into the first movement, and that first movement, of course, starts with is Mozart, could be Haydn, could be Boccherini. You know, you would say to yourself, what is this? You know, is this the Toy Symphony by whomever has composed the Toy Symphony? You know? And it starts with that little tingle-tangle and
bells.
Yeah. And you're on a sleigh. You know,
yeah,
and you're going somewhere,
isn't it?
Very gentle. You're in an innocent pastoral world. That's what you think, of course, because very soon the clouds will come in, dark clouds, heavy clouds will come in. And I'm coming back to a remark you made to the very beginning. Very interesting. You know, you're on that road. Is he that involved in it? Of course he's very much involved in it. But all this are like figures moving behind a veil. And that veil also, in the dark moments, obscures the naked horror. He's not yet there.
Yes.
He has not felt it completely.
No.
But don't forget, the year in 1901, he will be composing the three Kindertotenlieder, three of the four Kindertotenlieder. This is extraordinary. This is the moment where he's passing from one world in which he takes distance of horror, and before he gets fully into it.
And you were saying that the Kindertotenlieder are, you need to have them as companion music to this.
I think it's a kind of mirror.
Right.
When listen to the Fourth Symphony and listen to the Kindertotenlieder. There are two more that he will compose later, but you know, this is listen to those things at the same time. It all has to do about children. It all has to do about innocence being taken away also.
You know,
innocence will be taken away also.
Absolutely.
His innocence being taken away at the discovery of the world, and it happens at the same time that he marries Alma Schindler. And this is terrible, I mean. This is absolutely terrible. And the Kindertotenlieder, the songs of the leader of the dead children, will precede by 5-6 years the death of his own child, his oldest daughter, who was his favorite daughter. It's very strange how we are entangled with our destiny and how these things evolve from one to another. But if you want to know what the destiny is about, listen to the 10 symphonies by Mahler, one after another. So we are in the fourth symphony. We are in that first movement, which is an extraordinary movement, where it goes up and gets very strong and it gets very dark, and then suddenly it all disappears.
Yeah, it's like it unwinds, doesn't it?
It unwinds, absolutely. Yeah. And it disappears into nothingness. And then suddenly there's that little tingle-tangle coming along, and you start moving again, and you go forward. Well, that's what life is about, isn't it? You know? And you go forward, and it's almost the same thing as in the beginning, but is it? And you get into the second movement, and you have this second movement, which is a kind of landler, a kind of village song. And it was called, it comes straight out of folklore, in fact. And it's played by a village fiddler. And the first violin of the orchestra has the honor of doing that. And with lots of solo elements that come in. Lots of solo elements, but the violin has been tuned one tone higher.
Do they actually do that?
Oh, yes. Yeah. There are two violins hanging there for the first violin with the Vienna Phil. I've heard it with the lots of big orchestras, and they have two violins ready for the first violin.
So he plays on his violin the first movement?
The first movement, then
puts
it down, takes it. You're so right. And grabs
violin.
The other one, and then plays. And then he's the fiddler. He's the village fiddler, and in fact it is death that takes the fiddle, because it is the image of Freund Hein spielt auf. So Freund Hein strikes up. Freund Hein is the man who pulls forward the people towards the beyond.
He's not a good.
He leads the followers to the land of the beyond. He's disquieting. You know, it's a very disquieting movement. It is the flute player of Hamelin. You know, that story of the
flute player, the
Pete Piper.
That's it.
There you go. The Pete Piper, and who takes these children as revenge into the other world, and in fact, that's it. Well, of course, the children have to go to the other worlds if they want to discover paradise, isn't it? Mm. And the voyage itself will happen in the third movement. Voyage will happen. Now, the second movement is Schubertian. The first movement was Mozartian. If you want, the second movement, very Schubertian.
Yes.
Wander, of course, the walk, going there, and you're being pulled forward by the Pete Piper. And you get into the third movement. And the third movement is young Beethoven. It's romantic Beethoven. It's the first and second period of Beethoven. You have this extraordinary, very warm for the violins, for the strings, fabulous parts.
Beautiful long lines.
Long lines, yes.
A lullaby. Yes.
And but it's not as simple as usual. What we have been saying about the two first movements is so true for the third movement. It's a transfigured lullaby. It's the lullaby that opens up to the other world. It's a lullaby that will put you to sleep. But what is sleep? Sleep is dreaming. Dreaming is sleeping. Sleeping is also death. Sleeping renewal, but sleeping death. And all these images come one into another. And there are very, very, very nice things said about that movement, of course. And it is an extraordinary movement.
Well, the first time, maybe I'm throwing you completely off track, but it's sort of because you're talking about an arrival in paradise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's not paradise, it's somewhere good anyways, mm-hmm. and peaceful. But mm-hmm. At the first few times I listened to mm-hmm. the symphony, I thought after the third movement, he could have stopped. It was perfect like that.
It was perfect.
Wasn't it?
Yes, but you have to get to paradise.
That's it?
You have to get to paradise. And it's a totally different world. And he ends, of course, he ends that movement with very strong, the doors opening. But that music is really doors opening, and they're opening to this voice.
Yes, and this that voice, device, yes.
That voice that just glides into your subconscious, you know. Mm-hmm. But before we leave that movement,
yes,
I wanted to quote what some musicologists have quoted. And he's a writer of a naturalist writer of the end, a British writer of the end of the 19th century, the time of Mahler. And his name is Thomas Hardy. And when you listen to that movement, you feel what Thomas Hardy said: "I seem where I was before my birth, and after death, maybe." And that's why I said that movement is the going towards, because this is what our life is about, isn't it? This is what our life. So it's that moment where I was before my birth and after my death, maybe. And this is now. Because you only can think it now. It's an extraordinary sentence, and I think it says so much about this transfigured cradle song. You know, and of course everything that happens in the two first movements deepens and dignifies the symphony with music that is absolutely of meditative beauty. This is great Beethoven. This is great Mahler. And opens up then, as we said, to the song. And then that song suddenly that song, we have left this earth of tears and tragedy. We get into melodies that have and a text which is enjoying the heavenly pleasures and avoid the earthy things. No worldly tumult does one hear in heaven. Everything lives in the gentlest peace. We lead an angelic life. Nevertheless, we are very merry. We dance and leap, hop and sing. Meanwhile, St. Peter in the sky looks on us. You know, there's the father figure, the bearded father figure. You know,
all is well.
All is well.
Yeah.
All is well because we're not there anymore. This is my cynical view, but it's very true. I mean, this is very true. And so the singer, the soprano, goes to 5 strophes, 5 parts, and some parts are absolutely, they're so merry, they're so nice, they're so simple, so straightforward. Von der Horn song, of course. And I like, especially, you can have all the vegetables. What I really like is that wine costs not a penny in heaven's cellar. Yeah, there you go. You know, wine is free, and no taxes on it. On top of that, that's the only province where there are no taxes anymore. And we have to smile at this. We have to laugh at this because this is so true. So then should a fast day, you know, the day of fasting arrive, all the fish swim up to us with joy. Over there, St. Peter is running already with his net and bait to the heavenly ponds. And you know who's going to be the cook? St. Martha.
Of course.
And all these wonderful things are happening, and the music is, if ever there is purity, it's in that music. If ever there is innocence, that's in that music. But you know, that comes in the last paragraph, that comes in the last part of the song. Because suddenly, There are all kinds of, you know, the accompaniment of the orchestra is very interesting because there are dark moments in between the sung part. And then you get to that last one, and there Mahler unveils or puts the cards on the table. Because that part is about music. And you have everything you took at the first level. Forget about it. This was about what music is about. Because music promises what is other. What is beyond. And we can have it here. No music on earth can be compared to ours. There are a few other things in there which I wonder. Even Saint Ursula herself laughs. Cecilia and all her relatives are splendid court musicians. The angelic voices rouse the senses so that everything awakens with joy. So this whole thing is about music. Music as a solution, a resolution to what this earthy life does to us. And he signs off with it.
You know, I think we should... you just made me realize. I've played Mahler at the first level. Now with the text here, you're at the second level. And the third level is that with the last line of the text, Mahler tells us, and you know what? For the last hour, you've been enjoying heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Because you were in my music all along. And it's perfect.
Absolutely.
And
if you don't mind, I would like to finish on innocence.
Do.
Mahler, in a letter of 1901, you know, we are still in that period, okay. 1899, 1901, that period where he composes that symphony, he writes about Hoffmann, E.T.A. Hoffmann. And I translate a life, so I will hesitate perhaps a little bit from time to time. Quote, if you examine with a little bit of tenderness the works by Hoffmann, clarity will come up, new lights will spring out, will appear out of the singular reports that exist between reality and music. This music which is eternally mysterious and sometimes undecipherable, which suddenly, in a flash, illuminates all your interior world. You will know then that the only truth on this earth is our sensitivity, our heart. He called it Gemüt. And for which, and if you have understood that, the concrete is only a scheme, a futile shadow. And I will ask you not to take this as a poetical image, what I just said. On the contrary, it is, and he uses the German word Erkenntnis, a constatation. This is truth. An inevitable evidence, irrefutable, even under the cold assessment of rationality. This is extraordinary text. This is an extraordinary text what says what this work is about. It says what the relationship is, that the relationship between reality and music is something that bypasses. It promises what is other. And we discover it in a flash of suddenly, like that. And that's what happens when you have a great performance, when you have a great concert. And it's what happens very often when you listen to the symphonies of Mahler.
Well, Jean-Jacques, I'm going to go home and put on my symphonies again, and I'm going to try to find a version of the Kinder Totenlieder.
Yes, do. And have listened to all this incredible innocence that is taken away. And at the same time, that opens our eyes.
And that's where reality is.
And that's what reality is about.
Thank you so much, Jean-Jacques. We'll talk again soon.
Thank you. Unserer
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.